marching out. There are some strange between Michelle and her mom and the stepfather, Paul. They didn't see eye to eye on a lot of things. So Michelle moved out and got her own apartment. To celebrate, Michelle went to the Bullpen Bar where she was supposed to meet her friends. Michelle stayed for about 25 minutes, talked briefly to some bar patrons, and had three drinks. We could see that she seemed to be acting appropriately. She seemed to be having a good time. Then she left by herself at 12:54 a.m. Michelle's friends, who were in Michelle's apartment building, left to meet her at the bar. But as they walked outside, they saw something unusual. It was a red pickup truck with a woman at the back of the truck flailing her arms. All we knew is that there was a woman who was in distress in this truck. Michelle's friends went to the bar, learned that Michelle had already left, and went back to Michelle's apartment. That's when they saw the red truck again, this time with no one in the back. Further down the road, they found Michelle's jacket, some jewelry, a blood stain, and a tooth. There was a watch mount that had been broken and had stopped at like 1:24 in the morning, which matched up with the witness statements that they saw this lady screaming in the back of the truck sometime shortly after 1 o'clock.
We're hoping for the best, but I mean, when you hear something like that, then you can't help but think the worst.
Our friends now.
We need a bed. Thank you. Hoot.
Hoot.
Move it on. Scoob. Scoob, scoob, scoob.
So it was a crazy drunk person, you know, partying.
She was trying to get out of the trunk. To the point of she was going to jump out of the back of the truck while it was moving. Unfortunately, Michelle's friends couldn't remember anything about the truck except that it was red. Police campus area hospitals. No one matching Michelle's description had been admitted. Law enforcement volunteers and family members searched the area looking for Michelle, but were unsuccessful. As time progressed, and we realized that we weren't finding her, she wasn't showing up at the hospitals, that this was more likely a kidnapping scenario. Tests showed the blood on the highway was the same blood type as Michelle's, but DNA testing would take several weeks. There was a pool of blood, and leading away from that pool of blood were drag marks in blood, which indicates that whoever was bleeding drug away. We got an opinion that if she didn't get immediate medical attention based on what we saw at the crime scene, that she was probably going to die. Now, it was a race against time, and police soon found a likely suspect very close to home.
I'm gonna sit up.
You need the way you do. Can't stay on the bed.
That's why your pizza stays untouched after making it 450 years. Saw Michelle walking through the parking lot, and because of the strained relationship, they didn't talk to her.
This took place less than an hour before her leather jacket and tooth were found on the side of the road. Paul could have dropped Mom off and come back to do something to her. Any number of things could have happened. Paul denied any involvement and passed the polygraph. The owner of the truck, Sean Phillips, also had an alibi for the night of Michelle's disappearance. He was 70 miles away in San Francisco. We were later able to identify him in some surveillance footage down there in the city at the time of the murder. After 4 days of searching, police found Michelle's nude body in a nearby river, covered in mud.
She had extensive blunt force injury on the head. It was both external bruises and abrasions and internal bleeding around the brain and within the brain. She also had a number of fractures along the jaws, lower jaw.
Despite the severe head trauma, the autopsy showed it was not the cause of death.
Since it was multiple blunt force injuries of the head complicated by drowning, she had been placed in the water still living.
Strangest of all, Michelle's killer had cut off almost all her hair.
It was pre-hacked. Only if you see her in surveillance video in the bar, she had beautiful waist length hair, and when we found her, it had been essentially hacked off.
This raised disturbing possibilities about the killer and his motivations.
People, especially men that kill women, have been known to do that. Retain a souvenir, for example.
That type of behavior is often exhibited by serial killers. If that were the case, there was no connection between Michelle and her killer. Discovered something else that could have been a factor in her death.
She had substantial amounts of both alcohol and methamphetamine in her system. She had substantial enough amounts so that if she had been found, say, deceased in her apartment with no injury, then those would have been considered the cause of death.
But Michelle was murdered before the drugs could kill her. She'd been savagely beaten, and her tooth and blood on Highway 116 made it clear. Her killer hit her at least once while she was on or near the highway.
She'd suffered severe trauma to her face. This was no vehicular manslaughter case at all.
I found no evidence of sexual assault, but I was looking for semen, spermatozoa, foreign hair, foreign fibers. I found nothing.
Shortly after Michelle Johnson's body was found, police checked the motor vehicle records of people living in the immediate area. They were looking for any males who drove a red pickup truck. Besides Michelle's stepfather, who had use of a friend's red truck, there was another man, Lou Casper, whose apartment was within walking distance of where Michelle's body was found. Kessler, a butcher, was 34 years old, never married, and had no children. A background check revealed a restraining order had been filed by a former girlfriend 2 years earlier. But what stood out most to police was his membership in a private club called the Odd Fellows Club. It was only a block away from the bullpen bar, and he was there the night of Michelle's murder.
One of the witnesses said he left about 12:30, quarter to midnight. They saw him walk across the street to the bullpen bar to get his truck.
This was about the same time Michelle left the bullpen bar. Investigators asked managers at the Odd Fellows Club for anything unusual
about that night or about Luke Kessler?
They said that Mr. Kessler was very intoxicated. He'd done some things that people had characterized as being strange. He was on purpose spilling his drink. And then when the waitress would come over, jump off of the floor, that he was peering down their tops.
Kessler was shown Michelle's picture. He said he didn't know who she was, and he'd never seen her. Investigators looked in the bed of Hassler's trunk and could find no blood, although it looked like someone had recently washed it. So investigators concocted a ruse just to see how Hassler would react.
Another detective took a napkin and a little bottle of water and kind of rubbed it along the back of the trunk bed, kind of simulating a DNA test.
At the time, Hassler showed no reaction, but later express his concerns.
He started making a few phone calls to his girlfriend and two other friends at that point, and mentioned that one of the conversations, you know, hey, they took a swab out of the back of my truck. So that really is what I think kind of spun him out at that point.
This was hardly enough even for a search warrant. But then police got a call from a woman who refused to identify herself.
She was very distraught. She only could tell me that she knew that Luke, a person that she knew as Luke Kessler, was involved. She just had a feeling this person was involved in the crime.
The woman wouldn't say how she knew this man or why she suspected he was involved in Michelle Johnson's murder.
So that was kind of the breaking point of the case, is we knew that Luke was involved.
Police, with nothing to lose, told Kessler about the call. And now, he changed his story.
Luke's story was that he had accidentally hit her in his truck, as she was in the middle of the road when he came around the corner or something.
Kessler said he put Michelle in the back of his truck to take her to the hospital. But Michelle regained consciousness and fled when he stopped at a traffic light.
Luke said she then jumped out the back of the truck, and that was the last he knew.
This story was consistent with the eyewitness accounts. They claimed they saw someone who looked like Michelle in the back of his truck, but later she was gone.
Luke's story could have made sense. I hit someone in a car and there's blood. That's just pretty normal.
But investigators needed more evidence if they were going to bring Luke Kessler to justice. Naked eye. The test showed it was human blood. under the front seat.
On the jumper cables, this was a set of 12-foot-long jumper cables. I found traces of blood along the entire length of the jumper cables, including the clamps at the end. DNA tests identified where the blood came from.
All genetic markers that we tested for the evidence samples, the blood samples from the car, and from Michelle Johnson all matched.
This left only one explanation. Michelle was inside Hassler's truck and bleeding. It totally contradicted Luke's story. She was inside the truck with Luke, and that it was her and Luke's truck. And he had said that he only put her in the back of the truck. Police believe Michelle, high on methamphetamine and legally drunk, was walking home from the bullpen bar. Luke Hassler, also drunk, was driving home at the exact same time and saw her. It appears he stopped his truck and probably made a sexual proposition. An altercation ensued. Hassler, who outweighed Michelle by more than 100 pounds, simply threw her in the back of the truck and took off. A few minutes later, Michelle's friends saw her in the back of the truck, although they didn't recognize her. 2 miles down the road, Hassler stopped the truck and got out. Michelle jumped out of the truck bed and, preparing for a fight, tore off her jacket. But she was no match for Hassler. He hit her in the mouth, knocked her to the ground, and she lost consciousness. He bundled her into the front seat, where she bled over the seatbelt, the floorboards, and the jumper cables. Hassler then made a U-turn and headed to his house. On his way there, Michelle's friend saw Hassler's truck again, but this time, Michelle was in the cab of the truck and they didn't see her. In an attempt to conceal her identity, Hassler stripped off her clothes, cut off her hair, and then threw her into the river, where she drowned. The next day, Hassler washed the truck both inside